morning, all of you. This is Nana, and then we are into the next day's program on manifesting. So, we have seen the cost roll up as well as the cost, how they are being done, and then how the cost is incurred, how the cost is relieved. There are two more things on the costing. If you run the cost roll up, what happens? There is a roll up option there. The roll up option says that whether you can go for a full cost roll up or a single level roll up. So one of them can be chosen now. So we will now see what exactly is a single level roll up as well as a full level roll up. So there is a big difference. So this you must know about this cost roll up. Whenever you perform it, the roll up option has to be properly specified. So we have to go and have a look at it now. You can see the difference between the single level versus full level cost roll up. Let us say that this is a cycle. So this cycle has got, say, a beam, and then it has got a frame assembly. The frame assembly has got a handlebar, a frame, and then a tilt. So it's a two level bill. This two level bill. This two-level bill basically has got the cycle in the top and then the wheel in the frame, and then below which what happens, you have the handlebar, you have the frame, you have the seat, all the pieces there. Now you can see the cost of each and everything. So let us say that now they are now updating on the pending cost. So initially it was $10, later on they have changed it to $15. Here it is $80 here. And in the back, in the below level, what happens, you have got a cost of 20, it has been changed to 30. And then here is 50 and then 10. So once when you perform a roll up for the cycle, what happens? If you say a single level roll up, it will now calculate the cost of this as well as this only. There is a wheel as well as the frame only. It will not explode the frame and then do the thing. Okay? So explosions of the lower level will not be done. So if you make a single level roll up, the cost has been changed from 10 to 15 now. So 15 to do is 30. 30 plus 80 is 110. So 110 is the cost. Actually, this is not 80. This is already changed. In the lower level, what happens? It was 20 and then it has gone 30. But this roll up will not take place at all. If you make it as a 30, what happens? The full cost roll up will be $90. So, if you are going to make a single level roll up, what happens is that if you take only $80 and not $90. So in the on the contrary, if you make a full cost roll up, what happens? It will now explore the bill totally, and then at every level, wherever the change is there, it will be rolled up to the previous level, and then afterwards it will be rolling up to the top level. So if you perform a full cost roll up, what happens? First, the frame is getting rolled up. So once when you roll it up, what happens? The 20 has got changed to 30. So 30 plus 50% will be 90. So 90 plus 30 will be 120. So if you perform a full cost roll up, this is also recalculated. In some companies, what happens, they don't want to do the recalculation at the lower level. So if that is the case, they will be running a single level roll up. If they want it, they will go for a full cost roll up. So this is one of the important differences which you have to know. So this is on the single as well as a full level cost roll up. Okay. You will now see one example of this costing, how they have done. The Oracle actually is an Oracle slide actually.
ஒரு
So this is an example of a routing cost example. Okay, what has happened? They have two resources, spin assembly as well as a setup of two resources. The type of the person, that is, the unit for measures is ours. The first resources are having a basis of item, the second one is having a basis of block, and then there's a cost of it. And then one administration overhead is getting associated with the both the resources. They have associated administration resources with the both the resources. Now, the overhead name. There are two overheads are there. One is administration, one is a packing. Both of them are contained in the department spin assembly. And then administration has got a resource value, and then packing has got an item. This is the item here, the resource value. So the rate for this is 1.530 here. The department is housing both the resources, spin assembly as well as setup. These two resources are housed in the department. And then the administration, the overheads are administration and packing. And then the rates are here for each and every. And remember, administration is having a resource value, whereas packing is having item as the basis. Now, operation fin is now being performed in this department fin assembly. And then they are using both the resources, setup as well as fin assembly. Now, the usage rate has been given as 1 and 1.5. Now, you see the costing of it. So, once you see the costing of it, so setup, it is now having an item costing lot size of 10. So, there is an item costing lot size also there, the costing card is in. So, if you say 10, what happens? So, we have to see for one item, okay? The cost is for 10 items. So, we have to see for one item now. So, if you see for one item, the item cost to be 1 into 1 by 10 into 20. Because the usage rate is 1, and then 1 hour actually, 1 hour of usage, and then 1 hour into 1 by 10 is the costing lot size, into 20 is the rate. You can see the rate of this. This setup assembly has got a rate of 20 per lot. See on this? So even whatever you perform, it will be 1 meter length, it will be $2. Now the finished good assembly is of item-based. Item-based doesn't cost you $15. So it is now used for 0.5 hours. So 0.5 into 15 is 7.5. It is not 15, it is 0.5 hours. So 0.5 into 15 is 7.5. So this is the total cost of the reserve for the product. Now you see the overheads which are being charged. So the administration overhead is getting charged in both of these, for setup as well as assembly. So in this case, administration overhead is what? So administration overhead has got a rate of resource value of 1.5. 1.5 times the resource value. So it is 1.5 times the resource value. So here what happens? It is $2 being sent. So 2 into 1.5 is 3. And then 7.5 into 1.5 is 11.25. Because it is the resource value. 1.5 times of the total value of the resource being charged in. Whereas packing is of a base, packing is of an item base. It's for every finished good which is being processed. And the rate of 30. So one finished good is being processed here. So packing of 1 into 30 is $30. So this much of a resource cost has gone in, and then this much of a overhead cost has gone in. So this is a very good example of various things being packed in one sheet. Any queries on this? This is how the routing cost example is being done. Now, there is one more thing on the average cost, so we will be seeing it on Monday, but not now. So today we will now go to the tough topic of lead time management now. Lead time management is a very tough topic, so we are going to go for it now. Now, having costed the product, including material as well as the thing, so what you want to do is, you are now going to do the lead time management now. Now, lead time calculation is coming up, so you have to ensure that these things are like this now. You will now query our finished goods and then ensure that these things are like this. Go there. We are going to bill of materials, routings, and then routings. Query our finished goods now for another organization. It is 30%, 30% is 1,
is the one. So we now keep our cursor on the first operation and then keep on the resources now. The resources is 30 man one. This is the item 6. And then 2 years. It is item 6, 2 years. The first line is correct. The second line will go on the negative of it. Close it. And then keep the cursor on the second operation and then have the break. Second, 4 years and then item 12. It is 4 years, item 12 is that. So this is also correct. So go there. Close it. Keep on the cursor, third one. Click on the operation resources. Here, it is a lot 24, 6 years. It is lot 24. 6 years is correct. Close it and go for the next one. Here, it is 4 years and then item 48. It is 4 years and then item 48 is correct. Go there in the final one. Make a check of it. Keep your cursor and then click on it. And then here, it is item 12 and then 1 no. So it is item 12 and then 1 no. Okay, fine. Everything is correct. Now we are going to see about how much of time it is going to take for manufacturing this product. So here what happens? The first resource is being used is required for 6 hours for completing one finished goal. And then we are now putting 2 assigned units for this. So the time taken will be usage divided by assigned units. Remember, during costing, this doesn't come into picture at all. Because what happens if you employ multiple people, the cost is going to be same because the time taken will be less. So the cost is going to be same. So assigned units will not come into the costing at all. Whereas it will play a very vital role in time taken. So now the time taken for this particular first 10th operation is 3 hours. So okay, 6 hours. No. And then similarly, it is 3 hours. And then this is 4 hours. This is 4 hours. And then here, this is 12 hours. And then this is 0 hours. Remember, the third operation is a log based one. Here, the time taken is calculated based on scheduling is going to be else. When everything has been scheduled yesterday, schedule is going to be else. There are 2 more things like prior and next are there. That is what they are overlapping time, actually. Some of the inspectors are going to work parallelly. So there, what happens is if you overlapping it, there's a very complex process that you can see the TPTs now. So they cannot have any direct demonstration for those things. It's not possible at all. So we are going to demonstrate with the only timing as scheduling as yes now. So this is what every resource is now charged sequentially one after the other. That's what it is. Now, usage time. What exactly is it? Time required for manufacturing one finished good is called usage time. So this, you are mentioning it in every resource now. Number of assigned units with number of resources planned to be deployed for the manufacture of one finished good now. If the basis is going to be item, what happens? The time taken and cost here under the FG is based on the number of FGs completed the operation. That is what it is. For example, on the operation request, if you move 8 FGs in the operation 10 and you charge 18 to 16 resources here into the operation, and the total time taken is 6 by 2 into 8. And that will be for 24 hours. A log based resource is a different one. Here, it views the setup of footprint. This log based is mainly for setup and preparation time, is basically for log based resources. When you want to set up the machine, or if you want to have a preparation activity, that will be coming at the log. So, this is a common time for all the finished goods which is going to be processed. So, if the basis is log, and you move 8 FGs into operation number sequence number 30, 30 is basically log based. If you move this much of assemblies over here, 8 FGs into operation 30, all the 8 FGs will be considered as only one lot and 6 assigned units will be there to the charge, and the time taken for setting up is 24 hours by 6 is 4 hours only. So 24 by 6 is 4 hours. This time required is independent of the number of FGs being charged into the operation. So for a lot based, what happens, the time taken will be constant irrespective of FGs, whereas for an item based, it will be multiplied by each and every. If 8 FGs are charged, so 6 by 2 into 8, that will be the total time taken. Here, even though 10 FGs or 8 FGs are charged here, it is now just simply 24 by 6 only, and then it doesn't get multiplied by 8 at all because it is a log based now. So now I am going to calculate what is the time taken for this now. I am going to see what is the time taken for this. So if you go and then we have to know, you go there, keep your cursor on this place, and then go for two compute lead time. This compute lead time is going to be calculating the lead time for us now. You go there, and then first of all, compute the lead time, go there, close it, and then keep your cursor on the top. Top or something. Right? This is a finished good. So you go there, go to tools, compute lead time. This is going to compute the fixed as well as the variable lead time for manufacture of this product now. Keep on compute lead time. Tools, compute lead time. Now, your concurrent is now getting launched. So, have a look at the concurrent. So, upon completion of the concurrent, we can see the fixed and then the variable lead time are calculated in automatic execution. So, you have completed. Come on, okay. Now, you go there. Now, having done this, you can say the fixed lead time, only one of the results is log based here. One of the results is log based. It is going to take 24 hours and then the number of assignment units is 6. So 24 by 6 is only 4 hours irrespective of the number of FGs being processed in this operation. So 24 hours, there is a lot. The remaining are all item based. They will be charged sequentially one after another. So go down and then have a look at it. Now, the fixed lead time is equal to 4 hours by 24 because it is expressed in days. So it is 0.166 days. The variable lead time, you can see. Operation 10. If you find operation 10, operation 20, operation 40, and then operation 50 are basically item based. So they are getting charged with sequentially. So it is going to take 3 hours here, and the next 3 hours, then afterwards what? 12 hours. And then this is not going to take any item, any time at all, because the scheduling is no, mainly because it is non-time based unit submissions. So since it is a non-time based unit submissions, it will not take any time at all. So 3 hours plus 3 hours plus 12 hours, that is how much? 18 hours is the total time taken for this manufacturing of one image. You go there. So 3 plus 3 plus 3 is 12, 18 hours, and then it's going to be 0.73 days. So now the fixed lead time as well as the variable lead time is calculated now. You can go and have a look at it in this place. You go to this place, and then go to navigator, and then query on the organization items. You go to items, go to organization items, and then you're going to make a query. Enter it. Here, you query the finished good now. The item is 30% FG percentage 1. You have 30 FG item 1. And then find it out. Remember, once when the item is assigned, afterwards, if you want to check the attributes, you have to go to organization items and then make a check. Entering, you are now making a check of it. Now, this will tell you the lead time which has been calculated. Go to the lead time calculation. This is the lead time tabulation of the item. So click on the lead time. It will now give you display the lead time over here. Now it has calculated the fixed lead time as 0.16, the variable lead time as this. Now remember, the lead time, yeah.
One question, in the calculation of the lead time, does the quality system are also considered part of operation?
Which one is it?
Traffic to quality check on the
things
to
perhaps
is that also part of the routing and operation?
Yeah, we have to have routing, reserves for quality check also. Suppose let us say the quality check is going to take around 2 hours time. What happens? You will be having one of the resource, one of the operation as a quality check, and then that will be consuming certain amount of time. So this may be performed, may not be performed also. But in fact, what happens as far as size is concerned, it is considered that everything is performed and then it is calculated for a normal operation. And remember that every operation is not a mandatory operation. You find that will be coming a bit late once you go for this count point, auto torque as well as backlash. So other end will say which is a mandatory operation. Sometimes what happens, the quality check may not be required or some other rework may not be required. So those things are also there. But the system will calculate simply everything scheduling as this. It is assuming that every operation is being performed. If you're going to make a quality check, that will be as a separate operation as this. So now we are considering only for the calculation purpose this one. So you can see that the fixed lead time is now 0.166 and then the variable lead time is 0.75. Go there and then have a look at it. Now, having calculated the fixed lead time and the variable lead time, the system will now calculate the processing lead time also. So, the processing lead time is the total integer days required for manufacturing of one lead time lot size of an item. One lead time lot size of an item. So, here you can see in the bottom, there is a lead time lot size is available. So, if the lead time lot size is say around, say 25, that means what? the first component will be manufactured in say 15 seconds, the second may be 18 seconds, the third may be 13 seconds. So if you average it out over 25 components, generally what happens is we can arrive at the exact figure. So the lead time lot size is basically for averaging out the manufacturing time. So otherwise you average it over a lead time lot size, you won't be getting the exact figure. What it is. So this is what it is. So for manufacturing of a one lead time lot size, what is the processing lead time you're going to calculate? There is a processing lead time for one lead time lot size. Okay. So the processing lead time is equal to fixed plus variable into LTLS. The lead time lot size. So in this case, it is 0.16 into plus 0.15 into 1. That is rounded off to the nearest day. Rounded off to the nearest day. So that's why here it is showing us the processing lead time as 1 day. So whenever you do the compute lead time, whenever you do the compute lead time, the compute lead time will be computing the fixed lead time, the variable lead time, as well as the processing lead time using this LTLS. So the compute lead time is none. So both and the have a lead time. So it has processed the processing lead time as fixed plus variable lead time for one LTLS rounded off to the nearest phone number. Now I'm going to set the LTLS equal to 10 and then again compute it. So if I set the LTLS equal to 10, we'll now see what happens now. I will now set this to 10 now. Commit. So remember, I am now making the changes in the organization item. So it is now set to 10. Now over 10 items of manufacturing, then only what happens, you will be able to get an approximate processing time. So this is that is basically more accurate. So if there is a case, in this case, you have to make the LTLS as 10, and then now we will now calculate the three things. We have the fixed variable as well as the processing lead time. Now, fixed lead time as well as variable lead time depends upon the routing. In the routing, whichever is having item based as the lot based resources will be contributing to it. So they will not be getting affected by the LTLS. So LTLS will be affecting only the processing lead time now. We will now go there, Alt W, go to the routing now. Now, keep a cursor on the top and then perform the tool's compute lead time again. The concurrent is not submitted, it has not gone to the back end, so we will now have a look at it, what exactly is. So, here, if it is going to be there, the variable lead time will be 0.75 to 10, that is going to be 7.5 days. So, the processing lead time will be what? 7.5 plus fixed, fine. Fixed plus LTLS into variable lead time, and that is again rounded off to 8 now. You can see the processing lead time coming as 8 now. So go there, have a look at it. Alt W and then go to the organization item number 3. Here, re-query the item now. Take a copy of it and then re-query. Go there. Paste it and then re-query. Now you can see the processing lead time is now 8 days. From 1 day, it has now gone to 8 days because of that. LTLS is going to be 10. So go there and then have a look at it now. The next activity is cumulative manufacturing lead time and then cumulative total lead time. The cumulative manufacturing lead time is now represented as CMLT and then the cumulative total lead time is going to be CTLT. Now, in our assembly, what we need is one thing. We are going to manufacture this assembly. So it is QT underscore FG underscore item 1. That is getting managed. It has got 3 components. It has got 3 components. Operation 10. And then I am going to have operation 13. And then I am going to have operation 14 now. I am going to have 3 operations only. You have to make a change now. Then just, you know. So, what happens to calculate the CMLT and then CTLT? I am going to make some changes to the routing. So make changes for routing by inserting a disable date for operation 30 and 50. 30 and 50, I'm going to disable it now. So in this case, you go there and then disable this operation now. Go there. And then you go to Alt W, go to the routings now. Number 3 is routing. Here, you disable operation number 30 and 50 for this. So you can go there and then put end date. The record has been updated, so if you want to do this, you have to re-query it first of all. Take a copy of it. So, take a copy of it and then re-query it. Because the data which is there in the form is different from the data which is there in the system, so it's unable to do it. So, go there. Now we have to re-query. Now this is the data. So, go to the data facility and then get the study. And go to the data facility. The 50th one. And remember, both of them are now disabled at around, say, 11 minutes and 12 minutes. So if you make a query up to 13th minute, what happens? You won't be finding anything at all. So if you make a re-query of this, so then, yeah, both of them are gone. It's good. So if you see all, what happens? It will show you everything, whatever has been disabled. So now, what happens in the future and current? 10, 20, and 40 is only there. And now, what I'm going to do, there's a material requirement for 30, I will now shift it to 40 also. Go to tools, go to bill of materials, and then here, what happens? I have a material requirement for 30, I will now shift it to 40 now. The COM3 is required at 30th operation, since it has been disabled, I'm going to make it as 40 now. To commit. So, I have only three operations, 10, 20, and 40. In this case, what happens? I'm basically avoiding this two things. One is what? The lot-based resource as well as the non-time-based resource for this exercise. Okay? I think I can go to routing now. So, the 30th one, you see, the 30th one is basically for lot-based resource, we have not disabled it, as well as the 50th one is basically a non-time-based one, so for calculation of any time, we have not disabled both of these. The material requirement for 30 has been shifted to 40th operation now. Now, if you see this, here, 10, 20, and 40 are there. So, here, what happens? We need a COM 1 here. This is a purchase item. So, then we need the COM 2 here. And then, here, we need COM 3 here. So, three purchase items are required. Right? So, the system is going to perform the operation of 10, 20, and 30. So, 10, 20, and 40. And three COM are missing available. So, these are all the purchase items. So, CMIT, this is called Cumulative Manufacturing Lead Time. What it will do is, it now assume that all the purchase components are ready in stores, and then we have to know, do the operations 10, 20, and 40 only for manufacturing of the top assembly. So, it will now assume that all the purchase items are ready in stores, which is what happens, it will not calculate the manufacturing time only. If any of the components is going to be a make component, okay, then it will now consider the time taken for make also. Otherwise, what happens? The lead time of the components are not considered by CMIT with their buy item. If any of the components is going to be make item, then that will be considered in the lead time of this. And then after this is ready, only this particular operation can be performed. Whereas, in the case of the CTLD, cumulative total lead time, here, it will now consider that all the purchased components have to be purchased, as well as all the make components have to be made level by level. If there is multiple levels, every level has to be made now. So, CTLD will calculate everything. So, you have got only two options. Okay, either CMLT. CMLT will consider that none of the purchased items are to be purchased, everything is ready. Whereas, CTLT will assume that every purchased component has to be procured. As though, what happens, nothing, there is no stock at all. Here, CMLT will consider all purchase items are readily available. Here, it will now consider that all the purchase items are not at all available. There is no intermediary between these two things. CMLT and CTLT, there is no intermediary. So, we can go by these guidelines, in fact. There are only guidelines for the time. So, we are going to see about how CMLT and then CTLT are calculated now. Go there. What is this? So, we have now disabled these two operations, and then I'm going to make changes also. Change the usage of key miscellaneous 4 from 48 to 24 hours. That's what I'm saying. So, we're going to make it. So, for arriving at a round figure, so we're going to do this. Load space, go to space. And the miscellaneous 4, okay, on this one. The 48th operation, you keep your cursor there. And then go down, and then click on the operation resources now. Here, what happens? I'm not going to make it as what? 24 hours now. Correct. It is now done. So it's 24 hours. So close it now. It is now done. So this is basically to arrive at a round figure now. So it's going to have 24 hours now. It is now done. Now, compute the lead time for 10 quantities now. LTL is about 10. I'm going to do it. So we'll now go there. And then keep your cursor on the top. But then go for the computing of it. Go to tools, compute lead time. We are now going to compute the lead time for 10 LTLS. Sorry, I made a mistake. I have to go on the naked side. Okay, go on and have a look at it. Go to the organization items now. Find the organization number. Number two, here. Yeah, LTN is the 10 only. So for this 10, we are going to calculate. We will now see what is the result now. Now, the first operation, you see, the first operation is going to take 6 hours, the 2 hours and 9 units. So it is going to take 3 hours now. The second one is going to have 12 hours and then 4 assigned units is going to again take 3 hours. Whereas the third one has been made as 24 hours, 24 by 6, 4 is 6 hours. So, to manufacture one finished good, what happens? You are going to have 3 plus 3 plus 6, that is 12 hours in total for manufacture of an item. And since the LTLS has been set to 10 days, what happens? It is off a day. 12 hours is basically off a day. So, 10 into half a day is 5 days. So, all these things are going to take place in 5 days time for one LTLS. Now, what happens? What is the lead time percentage you are going to see? Now, when these operations are going to start in time. Now, for manufacturing of one LTLS, what happens? This is going to start at the 0th day. And then, since there is a 3 hours, and 3 hours is going to take, after 3 hours is now taken, what happens? UTD is working upon. This is going to work upon. So, this will be taking another 3 hours time. So, the lead time percentage is only 25%. That is, the total time of 5 days, after 25% is elapsed, that is 1.25 days is elapsed, the operation 20 is going to start. And similarly, what happens? If the lead time is going to be 2.2 days, so that this will start after 50% of the total lead time. So, the start is getting offsetted by this. This is called lead time percentage. So, we are now getting offset by this. So, the start of the 3 operations will get offset by 0 days, 1.5 days, and then 2.5 days here. So, these are 3 days. As the total processing time of 5 days will be 0.25 days. So, this is now getting offset by this. If you go there, this operation 10 is going to start at, say, 0 today. This is going to start at 0 today. This is going to start at 1.25 days. That is, once when you release the job, once when you release the job for production, it is going to start at 1.25 days. This is going to start at 2.5 days. It is going to start at 2.5 days. So, operation 10 is starting at the 0.3, operation 20 is starting at 1.25 days, and then operation 40 is starting at 2.5 days. After the given a start, once when you release the job. So, this is what it is, the situation is. So, you can see the lead time percentage as what? 0, 25, and 50 now. You can have a look at it now. Go there. Please go to the routings now. Number 4 is routing. So, here, if you re-query it, you're going to re-query it, take a copy of it. You're going to re-query it. You can see the lead time percentage is 0, 25, and 50%. That is when the operation is going to be offsetted. Okay? Basically, it's called lead time offset. The lead time offset is where the operation is getting offset by this much. Now, you go for a complex nature now. Now, compute lead time has now given, now we are going to do this. Compute the lead time for LTLS is equal to 1 now. I will now do the calculation for LTLS is equal to 1, and then we will now see what happens now. So, if you are giving you a fixed lead time, and then the variable lead time, LTLS is equal to 1, the processing lead time is equal to 1, the CMLT and CTLT are not calculated at all. The system will not calculate it. So, I will now first of all put LTLS is equal to 1 and then recalculate the compute lead time now. Go there. Now, go to organization items number 5. Yeah, I will now make it as 1 now. Got it? So, it will be changed in that. So, again, re-query it. Take a copy of it. Re-query it. Now, make a change here. So, this is now 5 days because of this. You can see this is 5 days. So, I will now make it as 1 now, first of all. Got it? This is now 1. And then go to the routing now. Number 5 routing. Here. I will not keep the cursor and then do the compute again. So, the LTLS is equal to 1 and then I have computed now. So, go there and then have a look at this. And organization items. Yes. Re-query it now. Take a copy of it and then re-query it. Go for it. 3. It's still working. Concurrent is working now. Now it is completed, come out of it, and then re-query it now. Now you can see the processing lead time has been set to 1. Okay? So the fixed is 0, the variable is 0.5, the processing is 1. There is no value in CMLT as well as CTLT. CMLT and CTLT are basically absent here. So this is what it is. So if you do this, this will be done. Now, set the LTL as 10 and then run the concurrent tools, the roll of lead 10. I'm going to set it as 10. And then at this time, I'm going to run the roll of lead 10. I'm going to roll it over down. Upon rolling up, what happens? You will now get these two things. The CMLT and then CTLT will be calculated. So roll up will calculate only the CMLT and then CTLT, and then it will not calculate the fixed and variable lead time and processing lead time. So compute lead time is going to calculate the fixed variable and processing lead time. Whereas what happens? The roll up will calculate the CMLT and CTLT. So I'm going to change it to 10. So if I change it to 10, what happens? The processing lead time will now become 5 now. The processing lead time has to become 5, but that to be done only when you compute it. Now I am not computing it, I am only doing the rolling up. So rolling up will now use the processing lead time to roll it up, the CMLT as well as CTLT. So it will not recalculate the processing lead time, remember, rolling up will not recalculate the processing lead time, rolling up will only calculate the CMLT as well as CTLT. So this, for 10, 1 is wrong, but that will not be corrected at all. So go there, go to routing, and I will now perform the roll up of the lead time. Who is the roll up lead time? I am not compute lead time. I am not going for roll up lead time. Go for roll up lead time. So that is what the paper explains. So if you do the roll up lead time, there will be no change to the fixed and variable results. This means that roll up lead time will not calculate recalculating the fixed and variable lead time and then the processing lead time. So fixed variable and processing lead times are basically not calculated. So it will now show you 0.5 and 1. And then the processing lead time is 1, but now CMLT and CTLT are calculated based upon the processing lead time. Let's see. Go there, after correction. Now it is now done. So go to the place and then go to organization items and re-query now. Take a copy of it and then re-query. Let's see. Based upon the processing value of 1, what happens? The CMLT and CTLT have been calculated. So this 10 lot size has not changed the processing lead time. You have to only compute. Only when you compute the processing lead time, the fixed variable, everything will be calculated. Compute lead time will calculate the fixed variable and then the processing lead time, whereas the roll up lead time will calculate the CMLT and then CTLT. You must be very clear upon this. Now, run the tools, compute lead time for the same step. If you do it, what happens? This will recalculate the processing lead time as 5, but it will not touch the CMLT and CTLT at all. This compute lead time will not recalculate the CMLT and CTLT, but it will not do the recalculation of only these three, the fixed as well as the variable as well as the processing lead time. Remember, so both are basically sort of a mutually exclusive sort of thing. So only one, this will be working only for this. The compute lead time is going to calculate the fixed variable as well as the processing lead time, whereas the roll up lead time will now calculate the CMLT and CTLT only. So I am now going to compute the lead time for this. I go there. You go to the skills, RWU, and then go to the routing. And then keep your cursor on the parent and then do the compute lead time. Compute lead time, I am computing it. It is not done. I go there and have a look at it. Yes. RWU, and then go to the organization. Now, do the re-query of this. Now, computer will now set it to 5, but this will not be affected at all. It is still working. Now, you can see that the processing lead time has now gone to 5, but CMLT and CTLT is still respecting the older values. The CMLT and CTLT will be dependent upon the processing lead time, so that is not done at all. If you understand. Now, CMLT and CTLT are not disturbed with the compute lead time. Now, run the tools roll up. Now, if you roll it up, what happens? CMLT and CTLT will be set to 5 by each. Now, you go there, RW, and then go to R routing. Now, you do the roll up now. Go to tools, roll up. Roll up lead times. Now, they will all be set to 5 by now. Give it all W and number the organization item. Now, re-query it now. Still running? Yes. We got the CMLT and then CTLT set to 5 now because roll up lead time has rolled up with the processing lead time. Now, in this place. If you see, the CMLT and CTLT is reflecting the same figure, because what happens? The manufacturing time for the finished good is going to be 5 days. And then what happens? None of the component is having any lead time at all. So, the CMLT will assume all the components are available, and then it says that to manufacture this, we need 5 days. The CTLT will not consider the component lead time and then calculate it, since none of the component is having any lead time. So, that is also set to 5 days now. So, the CMLT and CTLT are now showing the same figure. Now, because of which, what happens? There is no lead time for the component at all. Now, we will go for the complex scenario now. Now, it is done. Now, I am going to set the lead time, processing lead time for T count is equal to 1 now. Once when you set it as 1, and then do the roll up, okay? You know, what is the roll up of what exactly is going to happen. Now, the compute lead time activity is over now, we are going to only roll up now. So, once when you roll up, what happens? This item, we will now see what happens here. Now, it is now set to 1 day. The lead time of this is set to 1 day. This will not be considered by CMLT at all. CMLT will not consider the buy item the lead time at all, whereas CTLT will consider the buy item the lead time. So, the moment you release the job, after a day's time only the component 1 will be ready. So, it is initially supposed to start at 0 today, now it will not start at only 1 day. There is a delay from the CTLT point of view. So, since it is delayed by 1 day, what happens? This is also getting delayed by 1 day, so it will be starting at what? 2.25 days 1 day. And then here, this will also be divided by 2 1 day. So naturally, what happens? It will now start at 3.5 days 1 day. So naturally, the total job will be delayed by 1 day. So CTLT will be set to 6 now, CMLT will be set to 5 now. You can see this. Because this component is getting delayed by 1 day, the total process is getting delayed by 1 day. So from CTLT point of view, it is going to take 6 days. From pure manufacturing point of view, it is going to take 5 days. Go there, go to this place, and then query the component 1. I'm going to query the component 1, 30%, comp percentage 1, I'm querying it. I'm setting the processing lead time as 1 day now. The moment I roll up the parent, what happens? Once I'm rolling up the parent, when I'm rolling it up, all the components lead time also will be rolled up and then put on the appropriate place at the cumulative total lead time. So this processing lead time upon rolling up the parent, when I roll up the parent, every individual component's the processing time will be rolled up to the cumulative total lead time. So we will now roll up now. So we will insert this, we will now go there, go to Alt-W and then go to the routing. Now again roll up. Now I'm going to roll up. So to the roll up lead time, I'm going to roll it up. The roll up lead time is going to come in the CMLT and CTLT. So click on roll up lead time. So it is now done. And since all the components are 5 items, what happens if you see here? First of all, we will not see this roll up now. Take the copy of this. Go there. Go there. Control of the button. You see? This is now rolled up to this place. When I rolled the top, when I rolled for the top, the individual components, the lead time, processing lead time has been rolled up to the CTLT. Now, this component CTLT is now set to 1 day now. In our case, the components of CTLT is not set to 1 day. Now go on and query the final assembly. Finish go to command. 30%, empty percentage, item percentage. Hello? Can you hear me?
Yogan for the GE audio conferencing system. Please enter your 7-digit access code, then press pound. Thank you. Please stand by. You will now be placed at the conference.
Hello, Mana here.
Okay,
thank you. You got that message. Now, what happens, I'm going to do this query now. 30%, FD percentage. It's a very complex one, so just try to concentrate. And then this you have to calculate everywhere. Go there and query it. Now you can see the cumulative total lead time for the manufacturer is now 6 days, whereas the CMLT is only 5 days. Because from the processing time, what happens is now adding up the other times, whereas CMLT does not consider the lead time of the component on at all. Because of which, what happens? CTLT has been set to this place. So, the CTLT is saying it will take 6 days to manufacture, whereas CMLT says it will only take 5 days to manufacture. So, it is considered that all the purchase components are readily available in the store. That is why it says it's 5 days. It is not considering any time at all. Now, we'll now go for another complex scenario now. So, we are done. Now, it is now 5-6 now. Step number 5 is now 5-6. Now, I am going to set up one more thing. Set the processing lead time of the component 2 also to 3.25 days now. We are going to set it up 3.25 days now. So we are going to see the result of this now. So comp 1 is 1 day and then comp 2 is 3.25 days now. Go there and then set it up. Go to Alt+W and then go to the here itself. You have to query for the component 2 now. Go for the query. 30% comp to percentage 2. We are going to query it. So here I am setting it up as 3.25 days. You will not see what is the effect of it now. Go there and then have a look at it. Now, since this is already delayed by 1 day, what happens is the moment I give a go, this comp will be available only after 3.25 days. Now, forget about this. Now, the next step, this is the first step, In this step, if this is the case, fine, it is going to be 1 day. And then this is going to be 3.25 days. So this job is going to be delayed by 1 day. It has to start on 03, but the component is available only at 1 day. So it is now going to be delayed by 1 day now. 1 day delay. So because of this 1 day delay, what happens? It has to start at 1.25 days. Now it will be eligible for starting only at 2.25 days. But this component is going to be available only after 3.25 days from the start time. So, operation 20 is going to be delayed by one more day. One more day delay. One more day delay. So, the CTLT will now show a figure of 7 now. It's not 1 day delay on operation 10 and then one more day delay on operation 20. So, the CTLT will be showing you a figure of 7, whereas the CMLT will still continue to show us 5 because all of the purchase components. Clear on this? So we will now pick up and then we are now going to run again, do the roll up now. I am now again going to do the roll up for the top component, okay? For the top assembly. I am going to do the roll up. Go there. Mm-hmm. Then we are here. And we go there, Alt+W, and then we go to this place, and then we are going to roll up. We go to the routings now. Keep your cursor there, go to tools, roll up lead time. I am going to roll it up now. It is now rolled up. So if you go there and have a look at it, go to the organization item. That's first of all query on the component 2. You can see the CTLT will be set to 3.25 days. Take a copy of it and then go there. Paste it. Very correct. You can see it is still running. It is not accepted. Control of Lemon, can see. It is very correct now. Yeah. Now the CTLT of the component is now set to 3.25. We will now see the final component. Go there. 30%. Let's keep it to this one. The next one. This is the one. So you can see the CTLT is now set to 5 days, whereas the CMLT is still 5 days only. The CTLT is 7 days now, whereas CMLT is now 5 days because it considers all the buy components ready. So go there. Now this is the one. Now make one more correction. As the component 3 has 5.5 days. Now the component 3 is going to take 5.5 days. So if you go on and have an analysis on this. So this, right, the next scenario now. The next scenario. here. So here, one day delay here, here also one more delay. So after this, what happens? It is supposed to start at 2.5 days, so it has to start now at 4.5 days. It will be now we are starting only at 4.5 days. But component 3 we now put at 5.5 days. So there will be one more day delay here. So operation 10 has contributed one delay, operation 20 has contributed one more delay, here one more delay. So the CTLT will be now shown as what? 8 days instead of 7 now. The CTLT will be showing you 8 days now. So go there and then make a change for the third component now. Go there, put it in place. And then query for the third component now. Go to query mode, 30% 3, component 3 now. So change the processing rate into 5.5 days now, correct? Now roll it up. Again for the parent, you are going to roll up. So go there and then roll it up now. So go to place, go to routing, and then you are going to roll it up. Go to tools, roll up lead time now. It is now rolled up. So you should go back and then have a look at the organization items. Now we will have a look at the component 3 now. It will now be CTLT will be set to this now. The CTLT has to be set to 5.5. Yes, it got set to 5.5. So CTLT for component are already set. So this is also set now. Now query for the finish good now straight away. 30% 1. Then down arrow. You can see now it is CTLT is 8 days whereas CMLT is still 5 days. Fine. Now go there and have a look. Now, but the system will not calculate like this. System has got an algorithm for calculating it. So since we are now doing manually, we are doing it. So here we can see how the system is going to calculate. So there are three operations: operation 10, operation 20, and then operation 40. And then the system has got an offset days. Every operation has got an offset days. Here on the top it is done. The offset days is how much? It is now starting, offset days is 0 for the operation 10, and then the offset date is 1.25 for the next operation 20, and then the offset date is 2.5 days for the operation 40. So it will now do a mathematical calculation of this. So for everything, what happens? The CTLT of component 1 will be taken, that is the component which is required at this operation, minus offset days, and that is going to be 1 day. It is 1 minus 0. At operation 20, the second component is required. The CTLT of component 2 is 2.25 days minus offset days. That is 3.25 days minus 1.25 days is now 2 days now. And similarly for the operation 40, what happens? The CTLT of the component 3 minus offset days is going to be 3 days. So the CTLT will now be calculated as the processing lead time of this finished good plus max of 6 ABC. That is how it is coming. The max is 1 day, 2 day and 3 day. The maximum will be added and then that will be coming up over here. That is the formula I use for calculating the CTLT. This is clear. So practically we have seen about how it is being done. So here, this is the day the system does it now. Now we are going to go for more complex scenario now. Now, CTLT assumes that all the buy items have been purchased and all make items to be manufactured. That is what it is. Now go to all items and then change the item attribute from make or buy to make. The third attribute, the third component is now going to be make and make as a make item now. The third component, what I am going to do, this component will be a make item. If it is a make item, then the CMLT will also come into picture now. The CMLT also is going to come into picture. We will now see what happens now in CMLT. So what happens here, for CMLT purpose, what happens? 10th operation is starting at 0 today, 20th operation is now starting at 1.2 days, whereas the third component being a make item, what happens? It is going to be available only after 5.25 days, whereas it has to start at 2.5 days. So, CMLT upon the third component, it has to wait here for 3 days. It has to wait here for 3 days. So, what happens? It will be now processing time plus the delay, the offset, only for the third component. So CMLT will be considering only this one, that is operation 40 only. Since there is no make item. 10 and 20, this days will not be calculated. So CMLT will be set to 8 days now. You can see the CMLT is going to be set to 8 days. And of course for CTLT, all the 3 steps are involved because whether it is a make or a buy, it is immaterial for CTLT. It has to calculate each and every. Even if it is a make or buy, it will not calculate. So all the 3 steps will come into picture for CTLT. And so again, it is only 3 days for CTLT. But CMLT is not going to consider only one line here. it is going to consider only one line here. So because of which 5 plus 3, whereas CTLT, even if it considers all the 3, what happens? It is going to be only 3 days. So CTLT also will be set to only 8 days. Fine. So what I am going to do, first of all, I will now set this as a make item, and then make all the components as null. Now make all the components as null. You are now seeing that the fourth step, the reference number fourth step is now getting established now. Right? So go there. I will not do this now. First activity. I will not go component one now. 30% one I am going to carry. I will not set that to zero now. What? I will not delete it. Commit. It will not delete it and commit. I will not go to the second one. You go there. 30% two and then I will not carry. Here I am again deleting it and then committing it. It is not done. And then go for the third item. 30% three. I will not delete it and then commit it. Sorry. 30% 3 and then 3 for it. So this I am going to delete it and commit it. It is not done. So all the three components have been removed. Fine. All the components have been removed. And then for the third item, I am going to make the general planning capital, the make or buy, the general planning capital. In this capital, I am now going to make it as a buy item. But make item. Now this is a make item. It is now giving you a note. We can ignore the note and follow this thing. So click on this. Now it's a make item now. Correct. Now CMLT will be considering this line also now. It is now a make item. So here we go there. Now we go to this place. So all the lead times that is removed from the third item has been made as a make item. You go there, go to the routing now. Number 5. Here. You keep your cursor there and do the roll up lead time now. Click on roll up lead time. Now the reference number 4 will be now. So 0.510555. That is the thing. So it is the same as reference number 4 now. It is the same as reference number 4. So you can see that after we have done the compute lead time as well as roll up lead time, there is a reference we are getting it now. This reference is going to come up now. So you must see this now. Go there. Go to all W. Yes.
This is the roll up, not compute.
Yeah. We have not done the computing. Computing will calculate only the fixed variable as well as the processing time. But since there is no change at all on the fixed variable and processing time, I am not doing any computing at all. Because we already set up as the LTLS is called 10 for the item, for the finished good, and then I am not doing any computing at all. Let's do item 1. Here you see, these three things will not be disturbed at all. Because there is no change to fixed and variable, so computing is not required at all. Now we can see the cumulative manufacturing item and then the cumulative total has been set to 0, has been set to 5 only, because what happens? All the components are having 0 lead time now. Comp 1, comp 2, comp 3 are having 0 lead time, with comp 3 as a make item now. Right? That's what it is. So here we go there, and then here we are going to introduce now. So having said this, now reset everything with the values. So the same values I'm going to use. So this is a 5.5, I'll now make it as 5.25 and show you it will be 7.75 now. So I can go do this. I'll now set up this and then I will now run the roll up again. I'm going to run the roll up. So computing has to be done only when you feel that there is a change in the operations or there is a change in the results. Then only you have to compute. Otherwise, we have to simply keep on rolling up. Go there. Go to this place. I will now set it up. Now I will now query the first item. Go for this. 30% one, I am going to do this query. The processing lead time is going to be 1 day commit. And then I will now go for the second item, second component, 30% two. Go there. I will now make the processing lead time as, say, 2.25. Commit. And then go for the third one, 30% three. Right. It's 5.25. It's a 5.5. I will make a change of this. Commit. It is not done. Now, if you do the roll up, what happens? Once when you do the roll up, it will now be calculating all the three. CMLT will be calculating only the third one. The CMLT will be calculating only the third one, and that is going to be 2.75 days. So 5 plus 2.75 days will be 7.75 days. And then CTLT will be calculating all the three, and then again it will be only the same thing, 5.75. So you will be finding here that it will be 7.75 as the CMLT as well as 7.75 as the CTLT. Since the third item is a make item, it is now getting changed. Since the third room is a naked up, so it is not getting clean. You go there and then have a look at it. Now, you go to this place and then perform this and go to fight and then do the compute latex. Now, rather roll up latex. And I'm going to roll up with these three new values of the thing. Okay, man? With the third item as a make item. You go to the organization item. You go there and then query this now. Fine. You can even query the same thing itself. Yes, long, that's the one. And then you query for it. Yeah, the compute, the cumulative latex has already come. Fine. Good. Now you see the manufacturing item is also populated here. CMLT is also populated because the third item is a make item. The CMLT is also populated. If you see the second component, the CMLT will not be there at all. 30% too. Right. Since second item is a buy item, the CMLT is not coming at all. The third item being a manufacturing make item, the CMLT is also populated for the third item. For the first and second components, you won't find the CMLT at all. Whereas for the third component, if you again see, have a look at it, 30% free if you have a look at it. The CMLT is also populated upon the rolling up of the parent. When you do the roll up of the parent, all the components below also will be set to the appropriate value. So it is not done. Now we will now go and then analyze the finished good now. 30% EMG percentage 1. Go there, down arrow. You see that it is now set to 7.75 as well as 7.75 in the both of cases. It is not set to like this. This is clear. The fixed variable and then the processing rate will not be disturbed at all unless and otherwise there is a change in the routing. Now, the lead times of the components are changed, so these are all getting reflected on the roll-up. Now, I am going for the ultimate one. So, here, that is not shown here this because this ends this exercise as much. But I will not show you one more example here because this was faced by one of my students, so that's why I am just telling you. So, what happened that, suppose, let us say, this component has been now shifted to, now this component is now required for 40th operation. He said, well, I'm not going to shift it to the 10th operation now. So at 10th operation, I need comp 1 as well as comp 3 as it. So comp 3 is already having 5.25 days there. It is having 5.25 days of the 10th day. So it is now required at the 10th operation. So, can you tell me how much of delay will be there on the 10th operation? The component 1 is having a 1 day delay, and then the component 3 is having a 5.25 delay. So, what will be the delay of the 10th operation now?
5.25.
Exactly, fantastic. You have done very correctly. So, the 10th operation is going to be delayed by 5.25. And then tell me, what will be the delay for the 20th operation from CCLT point of view? There won't be any delay at all, because what happens? This component will be available within this time. So there won't be any further delay in the 20th operation, and then 40th operation does not need any component at all. So from CMLT and CTLT point of view, what happens? CMLT will be 5 plus 5.25 as well as CTLT also will be 5 plus 5.25 days. That is how it will be set. So both of them will be set to 10.25 if component thing is shifted from operation 40 to operation 10. But you won't be doing it like this machine, but it is only for understanding purposes you are doing it. So we are going to test this, the ultimate test we are going to make it now on the weekend. You go there, you go to this place. Now you can see 7.75, 7.75. I will now shift the component from component 40th operation to 10th operation now. RW. You go to the bin now. I have now got the bin now. So the bin component 3 will be shifted from 40th operation to 10th operation now. Correct. It is now done. Now you close this bin, and then you re-query the routing now. Okay, I have to go to the re-query in the routing. Go there, go to the routing. Then go to the routing now. So re-query the routing now. Go for the space shift and then control of the one. Now the routing is re-queried. You go to the folders and then go to tools and then roll up again now. Once you roll up, you can see from the present value, it will be coming down 10.75 days. 5 plus 5.25, 10.25 days will be coming up. It's a very complex one, and then if you don't do it correctly, what happens, you'll be finding a big problem there. So, this has to be done very correctly. You go to the organization item. Now you see, 7.25 days, if you re-query this, take a copy of it and then go for the re-query now. 10 plus 7, you can see that. It is 10.25 days for both CMLT as well as CTLT. And remember, fixed variable and approximate are not a problem affected. And for every make component, the system will calculate the CMLT and CTLT for the parent whenever you roll up. And for the buy items, it will not calculate only the CTLT and then whenever you are rolling up the parent. This completes the discussion on leap time. And here what happens, we can even put this processing time manually, or otherwise we can ask the system to calculate automatically the computer time. And that is applicable only for manufacturing items. And so, buy items all the time are manually adjusted. You cannot do anything. Processing time, there is no algorithm to calculate the processing time at all. We have to enter everything manually only for buy items. Whereas make items can be manual as well as automatic. So we have now completed a very complex topic of lead time. We will now have a 10-minute break and then we will come back and then we will now attack the matter.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah,
actually, sir, since you have asked for it, I will not go for it. Actually, this costing itself is a very, the timing and costing is a very big factor of this. So, the pre-processing lead time is basically the time taken for releasing, let us say, is a purchase item. It is for releasing the purchase order from the time the demand is fixed. So, this is the time. The processing lead time for the purchase item is the manufacturer is going to take this much of a time plus he is going to deliver at our gate. So, it is manufacturing time at the supplier's facility plus delivery at gate is called the processing lead time. The post-processing lead time is nothing but the time taken from gate to inventory. And then, as far as purchase item is concerned, we can enter everything manually. The pre-processing lead time as well as processing and then post-processing can be entered manually. So, again, pre-processing is from the time the demand is felt up to the purchase order is placed. There is purchase order approved. The processing lead time is the manufacturing time at the supplier's facility plus delivery at our gate. The post-processing is from the gate to inventory, the time taken to move the material. And for us, for the make item, again, the pre-processing time is the time taken for releasing the job order. Releasing the job order. And then for the processing
time, but the planning time also considered in the
pre-processing? Planning time is not considered at all. Planning department is supposed to work separately. The planning time is not at all considered in the pre-processing time. The moment the parent, this thing, job is released, and for this, what happens? How much of time it is going to take for the release of the job is here? It is basically again negligible again. Pre-processing and post-processing for the manufacturing items are basically negligible. The post-processing is not considered at all, and the pre-processing is considered to be negligible. So, for a manufacturing item, the processing time is the only time which is not considered. So, here it is not. You cannot even enter it. Post-processing item must be zero when the item is made. Post-processing cannot be anything at all. And then the pre-processing is negligible for a make item. So, if you have anything, then you can do it. Because what happens is the time taken for releasing the job. So, once the job is now created, releasing will not take a time. Because releasing will be considered based upon the DJ manager. DJ managers will now see the availability of the resources and the manpower and accordingly they will release. So, what happens, there may be some preparatory time or something like that. So, that will be coming in the pre-processing time and again it is negligible. So, as far as manufacturing item is concerned, this is the processing time. That is the only thing which can be done. Yeah.
Example, like, if I take an order today, and my planning routine is going to only run in the night, and once it runs it up and then it will identify that I need to manufacture this item, and it will automatically create a job and it will send that to the shop floor only tomorrow. So in that case, the time that has been spent today and until tomorrow, would that be considered as pre-processing time?
No, not at all. So what you are considering is that, say, today I'm going to run the planning engine for this. And so the job, it is saying that it has to be released tomorrow. So the CMLT and CPLT will not consider the planning time at all. How much of time it is going to be. So they will be start to work only when the job is going to be made. Once the discrete job is being created for us. Once the DA is created, then only the lead time will come into picture. The planning department may even say after 2 months time you're going to manufacture or after 3 months time. The planning is basically depending upon the demand which is flowing in. The demand will come in the form of a sales order as well as a forecast. So the time, the planning, let us say it has to be manufactured after 15 days time, that doesn't come into the lead time at all. So planning will give a lot of recommendations. Then you have to start the manufacture everything. Right? So it will even create a job and then leave it as it. It will not release it also. So, once when the job is created and then once when the job is going to be released, that is basically called the pre-processing lead time. And then assume that everything is ready and then you have to do it today itself. And then there is some shop floor delay because of which you are not releasing it immediately. Then only what happens, the pre-processing lead time will be coming into picture for a make item. And that is normally negligible. Only the processing time is the only time for manufacturing energy is considered, and then post processing we cannot enter anything at all here. Post processing is not applicable for a make item at all. Whereas pre processing is normally negligible. So here planning time does not come into picture at all as far as this lead time calculation is concerned. Whereas planning has got a separate what you will be seeing on a Monday, yeah, small introduction to MRP in which what happens we'll not see how the planning is releasing various jobs automatically as well as manually. That will be seeing it on Monday. So planning doesn't come into it. So if you run the MRP today, MRP may give a recommendation tomorrow or day tomorrow, it doesn't come into it. Because MRP will be having variable timings for this release based upon the sales orders as well as the forecast entries which are coming in. So this clear? So we complete the discussion on lead time now. So we'll have a small 10-minute break, we'll come back and then we'll now see the balance. Thank you. okay, thank you. We are starting the next activity. So the next topic in this is compoint and order charge. Compoint and order charge is the next topic we are going to see this. So they have given some examples here. For example, one assembly is now getting manufactured in 5 different operations, and assembly one. And then what happens is the 30th operation is basically painting operation. If color and texture do not meet the standards, send to operation 40. If job meets standards, send to 50. So it is not necessary that you have to do all the operations sequentially. You may even bypass, even branch based upon some testing activity or this. So 40th is basically a rework. So this rework will be performed only when the 30th operation demands the 40th operation. Otherwise, what happens? There will be normal send to 50th operation. So we are going to see but how the count point and auto charge is going to work. There are 3 things are there. One is count point, one is auto charge, and then one is backflash. Remember in WIP, whenever you perform any operations, the materials are backflashed basically by 2 methods. One is the operation pull, one is an assembly, and then push will be basically manual. So these are the 2 automatic ways by which what happens, the inventory gets decremented, and then the activity is called backflushing. You are getting backflushed. Just upon completion of an operation, just upon completion of an assembly into inventory, when you inventorize the product, at the time what happens, these 2 things are coming up in picture. So the count point and auto charge. So these 2 things will decide. Okay. Which operation? Okay, about when the operations are performed. When operations are performed. Let us take a scenario of this. Okay. The count point is on, auto charge is on, back pressure is on. The 20th. It is off, this is on, this is off. The 30th operation. This is off, this is off, and then this is off. The 40th operation. It is again on, on, and then on. The 50th operation. Right? Again, what happens? It is again on, and then this is on, this is off. So, let us say it is having initially. So, whenever you have the combination, there are 3 combinations that are available here. One is on-on, the CP and AC, the count point and order test. The first combination is on-on. The second combination is off-on. And then the third combination is off-off. There is no such 4th combination like this is off, this is on, and then this is off, this is ruled out. Vishu. You cannot have such a combination at all. When count point is on, auto charge has to be on. Auto charge is basically when you are going to charge the resources basically. So these 2 tick marks put together will now decide which operation are going to be performed. Here, this is called the mandatory operation. Mandatory operation. So that is what this will be definitely be performed by the system. Whether you do this or not, the system will assume that you have done it. So, what happens when you want to move an assembly between 10 and then 10 Q and then give a tap? The system will automatically take you to an operation step which is having both of them are on. From an on-on state, if you put a move on the thing, the system will automatically populate the 40th is the next step at the time. So, if you say completion of this, what happens? Whatever will be the intermediate steps which are having CP off and then AC on, will be automatically charged. They will all be automatically charged. And then this is having both as off will not be charged. So this is a sort of a rework or a repair. Rework or a repair. This will be performed only when you explicitly move to this operation. If you are moving from 40th to 30th, okay, if you move from 40th to 30th, then what happens? It will be getting charged. If you don't move it to explicitly, what happens? It will never get charged. Whereas 20th is not the case like this. Here, count point is off, but auto charge is on. So once when you move an assembly between on to on, all the intermediate operations which are having off on will be automatically charged. So actually this means what? This is a mandatory operation, rather than it's going to take 30 minutes. And then off on operation is taking the take only 1 minute. And then some other operation is also having off on, that is also going to take some 2 minutes with the. So these operations are basically going to take place very fast, and then there will not be any time for the operator to come to the machine and then make an entry of this completion of this printed operation. So this is basically non-time critical, and then what happens is going to take lesser time. And then this we need not have to inform to the management also that this operation is completed. Whereas management is interested in seeing this completion because it is going to take a considerable time, they would like to see it, whether you completed or not. So that's why what happens, this becomes a mandatory operation within 48 and 50. So the cursor will automatically take you from 10Q to 40Q if you put it on this. 28 and 30 will not be coming at all. We will now show this as an example. Now, so this is an example. Go there. Go there, please. Close it. The latent is now closed. Now, routing. Okay. I will now go there. I will now display all. And then I will now remove this end date now. I will now have 5 such operations for me. Connect. I have 5 operations. Okay. We will now do one thing. We will now go to the count point and auto charge. This is a bit. The count point and auto charge is not shown. Okay. First one is on off. Okay. Second one is off on. Okay. Third, 30th is off off. See this. 40th is on on, then 50th is on off. Okay. Now we are going to see which resources are charged. If you put 10Q and then give a tab, the system will automatically point to 40Q now. On the move assembly. Okay. On the move, it will be showing you 40Q assembly. So we will now see this now, right? It's not done. So come out of it, and then we'll now create a discrete job for this assembly now. I'm going to get a discrete job for this assembly. So this is basically as per this example, what you see now. So as per this, what happens? On, off on, off off, on. This is what we've been set. The one point out of the matrix has been set. Now we are seeing only the operations. Which operations are going to be charged into this place? Okay. You go there. And then go to this place. Now, first of all, what happens before you do it, we will now do the concurrent managers for resource charge. Go to inventory, go to setups, go to transactions, go to interface managers. Go to the interface managers and then switch on the concurrent which are responsible for this. Okay. And then both the material transaction and move transaction as we are on, so they have to run as the SRS. You go there, go to tools, launch manager now. Click on launch manager, I'm launching it. Here, this zip motor transaction manager, you have to schedule it now. I'm not scheduling it every 1 minute. Keep on periodic, make it as 1 minute. It is not scheduled. You okay? It is not scheduled. So, that what happens? The resources will be getting applied automatically. Click on submit. It will now start to run every 1 minute. And you can see control of open, it has not become active. Similarly, material transaction, these two transactions have to be run as a SRS. Remember, they have to be run as a SRS. Go to tools, launch manager now. Here again, I'm going to schedule it to run every 1 minute now. Take on periodic. Make it as 1 minute. And are we okay? It's not run. To submit the concurrent, this will also run every 1 minute automatically. So, the both of them have become active. Apart from the task manager being active. So, this is the navigation for this. So, inventory setup transactions interface managers, where you have to make these new transactions as well as metal transactions as a SRS. Okay, so it's not running as a SRS. Now I will now create the discrete job for this assembly. You go there, go to the web, go down, and then go to discrete job. I'm creating a discrete job now. You go to the job, and then what happens? I'm now going to go for a new job. Click on the new job. So the job is what? 30_3. Job 3 will done. So job 4 will start. The assembly is this assembly. 30th DHL 1. Go there, start quantity 10. And then give a start time. Congratulations. And then you go to the routing and then see the FGA is also there. Okay, submit. I will now release this job now. I will now release this job. Release the job. The job is now released. So have a look at the routing between which are there. Click on operations now. For this, we'll be having 5 operations now. This is the 1 point auto charge on this. So I'm going to move from 10 Q and then give a tap. The system will automatically point me 30 Q, 40 Q. So once when I make it to 40 move, you can see the operation resources which are required for operation 10, operation 20, and then operation 40 are charged. The 30th will not be charged at all. That you can see now. So come out of it, and then go to the W, and then go to the navigator now. So from here, what happens? I'm going to perform move transactions now. Move transaction, the navigation there. We are going to move the assemblies across the shop floor. So we can even move zigzag as per the requirement. Go there. And then put the fourth job now here. The job number is 13%, 4, and then give a tap. You give 10, and then give a tap. You can see the 40th operation is automatically defaulted. It doesn't mean that you have to do only 40. You can take it anywhere, but the system automatically defaults to a place where the CP on, AC on to other operation which is having CP on, AC on. It will automatically take you to that place. So that is the one. So it does not take it up. So I will now move it. 2 minutes. I will now make one assembly now. I will now make one assembly. From 10Q to 40 move I am making it. So this is what the assembly is completing. Operation number 10, operation number 20, and then operation number 40. And not operation number 30. Right? Operation number 30 is not performed. So, what happens to it? So, in this case, now the software transactions that take place is not completed. So, the second operation, which is having count point off and an auto charge on, you see, the count point off and an auto charge on is getting charged automatically once when you pass through this. So, this is basically a time, non-time critical job. And then the management do not want to monitor the activity on this particular thing. So that's why what happens, anything which is CP off and then AC on gets charged automatically. That is what it says. You go down and then have a look at it. Phone point off and then auto charge down. Assign this phone point operation that you always perform in routing, but that you do not want to monitor the assembly's moves. Assembly moves you do not want to monitor. Into and out of these two operations. For example, choose this one point operation for non-bottleneck operations that are not labor or time intensive. So which is not labor, such as inspection or minor assembly operations or whatever it is. You will now use CP off and then AD on. Work in process automatically completes the operation and then charges get more transactions to your job schedule. When you record a move transaction through or beyond the operation, as this one point is charged. So from a CP on to AC on, if you move it, it will now do the recording of this. We had to wait for 1 minute. So we go there and then now have a look at it. You go to this place, you go and then have a look at the discrete job now. The discrete job is there. Re-query the job. You take a copy of it and then re-query the job. Now re-query it. And then go to the operations now. And then see the quantities which are applied. Okay, now move this much has been moved. You will now go and then see the resources now. Okay, from one quantity has now moved to 2 move now. You can see the 30th operation is not completed at all. That itself indicates that it is a CP off and then AC off. So the assembly has not completed the 30th operation. Unless it is explicitly moved to the 30th operation, it will not be completed at all. And then now we can see the resources being applied on this. We go to the operations. And then click on this and then click on the first one and then click on the resources. You can see the resources have been applied. What are the quantities? It takes some time because that concurrent has to run. So generally you can see this. So this is that just the resources can be seen. And then you can even see the quantities of this. Come out of it and then have a look at it. Go to the description. Go to the main. And then go click on 30 and then see the components now which is being issued. So go to the quantities. Okay. The concurrent has to run, generally what happens, how much is issued will be coming up now. So that is not coming at it. So but once in the concurrent runs it will be coming. Whereas here it will be clearly showing you that the 30th operation is not performed at all. The 30th operation is not performed. So here now if you perform from 10Q to 50Q, 48 will also be performed. That's what it is. If you move from 10 to 50Q, even though 48 is a mandatory operation and then you are not performing it, the system will assume that you have done the 48th and then you will go to 50th now. That is what you see now. So from 10 to 50, I'm going to move straight away. So even though it is a mandatory one, it will be performed automatically by the system now. Go there. Close it now. Okay. You go down. And then Go to move transaction again now. Go to move transaction now. Go to navigator. And then I am going to perform the move transaction for the fourth job now. It is 30% 4 and then you are done. Perform the move for 10Q to 50th move. Now it is populating as what is 50th to move. I am going to make. So I will now move one more assembly here. Now you can see this will be performing 40th also. But 30th will not be performed at all. So, the mandatory operations will be performed whether you move it or not, and then whether you move beyond or not. Even if you move beyond, what happens? The mandatory operations will always be performed. And then whatever is done with the CP off and AC on also will be performed. Whereas, which is both of them are off, will not be performed at all. Otherwise, you explicitly move. If you move as assembly to this place, at the time it will be getting charged. So, go there and then have a look at it. And go to the straight job somewhere. Discrete jobs. Yes, again, re-query this. Take a copy of it on the re-query. If you go there. So, it's re-query now. So, now here, you click on the operations now. You can see now, two assemblies are completed. This one, as well as, you know, on the process. It's not coming. The two more has come. Only one assembly has completed this now. Because the only one assembly has come over here. So, the 40th operation for the second assembly has been completed also, even though we are not moved via the body. So, that means what? It is not considered as, it is not completed as an assembly. So, this is on the operations being used. Right? This CP-AC on combination, the CP and AC combination will decide which operations will be performed. Now, come to back question. Now, whenever an operation is performed, its component is required. This component is applied. So let us say all of them are having AP, OP as a supply type of operation code. That means what? Upon completion of an operation, it will be automatically backflash. So if this is on, once when this operation is done, once when it is completed, what happens? The material will be backflashed automatically. Now this is what. Now even if you do this operation, now it is already done. So this will not consume this material which is required for operation number 30. And then 30th also is not done. So once when you go to 40, what happens? Whatever the previous operations have been completed between the BF on to BF on. So between these two statuses, whatever operations have been completed, those operations quantities will be backflashed. So this is on the backflash. Backflash is whichever operations are being performed, those operations for which from the BF on to BF on, all the intermediate steps will be backflashed automatically. And remember, the 50th step has to be CP on, AC on, and then BF on. So all the three must be on for the last step of this. So this completes the discussion on count point, auto charge, and backflash. We are now going to the next topic. Now, the next topic is the shop floor status. Let us say at the 20th operation, again, I will now first of all reset it. I will now want to reset everything as a normal thing. So, what I will do, I will now go to the discrete, go to job schedules. Whenever you want to modify anything, what happens? You have to go there and then modify this. You go to this place, you go to operations now. Jobs and schedules and operations here, the modification will take place now. I will now modify with everything as wrong. Ready for the fourth job now. It is 30% 4 and you attack. And then I am going to find it out. Here, I make everything as on. For the example, okay? And I made everything on. So, commit. It is not that. So, the changes can be made only at the jobs and schedules. Okay? It's not that. Now, on the 20th operation, what happens at the run stage? At the 20th operation, every operation has got a 5 inter-operation step. At the run stage, what happens? We want the customer to come over there and then inspect it. And then after his inspection only, we will say it is completed. So, fine. Or otherwise, 2 move, we will say. 2 move. At the 2 move, what happens? We are now going to put a status. The shop floor status is going to be done. Okay? It is a customer acceptance or customer test, customer inspection. So we will now go there and then now create a shop floor status. The navigation is lift, move transactions, shop floor status. We are going to get it. Go there and get it. So here, what happens? I am now going to say, custom inspection now. We are now going to allow moves. No moves are allowed on this shop floor status. It is not done. So customer inspection is not done. So there. This is the one. Now, what happens? I'm going to assign this customer inspection to a job now. Assign software services to this job. After having created the inspection there, with no moves allowed, you go there and then assign it. Here, query for the job 4 now. 30% 4 and then you're there. And then find out. Here, on the 20th operation, to 2 moves. There are 5 inter-operation steps are available here. You can see all the 5 inter-operation steps. You know what happens? The 2 moves, I'm going to put the shop load set available. Okay, fine. It is a cust and then go there. To the 1. It is not going to allow the move at all. Not going to allow the move at all. So, fine. It's not done. Correct. So, it has been put now. If any assembly reaches this step, what happens? It cannot move further at all. But if an assembly passes this step, it will now very well pass. But if an assembly has reached this inter-operation step, it cannot move any further at all. That you want to see. So, we have created a shop flow status as an assigned a job on a particular inter-operation step. Now, you go to more transactions of the same job. You go to more transactions. Go to more transactions, more transactions now. So, any question back, you're doing it. So, the job is what? 30% 4, and then you have. So, here, I will now move an assembly from the 10th to 1 to say, 20th thing, 30th I'm going to make, 30th set to move. So we have a what's called a shop floor status at the 20th operation, but since we are crossing it, it will allow now. We are crossing it, it will not allow. It will not allow, it will not have any problem. Now I will not do this. 30% 4 you have. Now I will move from 10th to 1. So to 20th set to move. I have moved one assembly now. It has now reached the 2 move status of the 20th operation. Now it will not be further moved at all. 30% 4 if you go there, and then I will not go for this 20th operation. It will automatically say the 2 moves are over here. So if you click on the next step itself, it will now pop up a message. Status of this operation step disallows transaction. We have assigned the status as program program is removed from this operation step at all. So the moment you tap, then automatically from the 2 move, it cannot move at all. So it will not allow you to move from 2 at all. So if any assembly has reached this interoperation step, that is what, at this step, the customer inspection is required the other way. So what do you do? The customer has inspected it now. Now we have to allow it now. So after he has inspected, what he has to do? You have to go there, go to the shop floor status, and then go to this place, and then go to the shop floor status itself, and then make it as allowed. That means go there, and then make it as allowed. Allow move. Right? It is now done. Now he can move it now. You go to this place, you can go to the move transaction now. Now we can move the assembly now. Go there. 30% 4 and then you tap. Here. Now, what happens if you stay 20 and then give a tap. Now, to 30 and then say to Q. It is now allowing this assembly to be moved because that status has been removed now. So what happens, whenever anything has reached, what happens, you have to again go on and remove it. And this is a very tedious job. This is again a tedious job. So go there. And then after just move, you remove this alarm mode. So this has to be done very frequently. So if you are going to do a bulk operation, and everything goes over there, not one by one, then it will be easy. Otherwise, what happens if every individual component is coming, you have to remove the tick mark again and again. Introduce the tick mark. So this is a slightly tedious job, but this is everything is available to stop any assemblies. Even with mistake, they cannot move it. This is the one. Now, here, now we are going to see assemblies which are having the serial control and lock control. Right? Correct? Yeah.
Can you explain the five steps that you have in Q, run, or Q move?
Yeah.
And what is significance on a software thing? I mean,
see, the queue is basically what? The queue is basically what? It is going to see. You know, go there. You know, finish the job. 13% 4, you have hands up. You go down. And then click on the operation. Number of the quantities now. So there are 5 operations of that. 5 inter operations of that. One is the queue, one is the running. One is a 2 move, one is a rejected, one is a scrap.
Yes.
So, in the queue means what? Now it is in the beginning of this operation. Once the operation is getting performed, you will be moving it to the running stage. Once the operation is completed, you will now take it to the move stage. during the operation, what happens if you feel that something has got damaged or something like that, you will not take it to the rejected stage. So normally what happens from the rejected stage, you may even take it back to the move stage if you do some rework or make some patch work and then make it okay. But if it is beyond repair or beyond that it has got fully damaged, then you will now move it to scrap. So once it is scrapped, what happens? It will be normally the job will not be earning cost any further on any further operation stages. So it will be scrapped and then kept it over there. So this is the five
only the the 20th operation will start only when the 10th operation will be moved.
Yeah, actually what happens is we can even move zigzag also. From 10 to 40 can move, from 40 to 20 also you can move, depending upon the shop floor requirement or the way in which you have done the sequencing. Because 20 may be a rework, 30 may be an inspection, 40 may be the next step. So if you feel that it is not required, you can go from 10 to 40, but then afterwards you can again go back to 40 to 20. And nothing is automatic here. The system will...
My question was the next operation would start, if you just said 20, 30 or 40, whatever it is. It's not only the prior operation
that
has
been
removed, right?
Exactly. That is true. Because what happens, even from here, from the running, if you make it to 30th queue, it is assuming that it is completed the 20th operation, it is completed the 20th operation, and then completed the 30th operation. So when you move in a very quick manner from here to here, say from 10 running to 50 queue, that means what? It has completed 10, 20, 30, and 40, provided CP, AC, and backups are all on. If you consider that this body is not completing these operations, then you are coming out here. It is not that just like that.
If you are taking the cases on running, I mean, generally say, if an operation can take like 2 days or 3 days, and it is in process, and somebody, who will be putting the status of running status for next 2 days?
Yeah, actually what happens is the 10th operation that is going to take 2 days time. It is in the running. So the discrete job managers will be responsible for updating this. Actually, they do not have to update, they have to perform the move transaction. Upon move transaction performance, the status gets automatically updated. So only when you move it, then only what happens, the assemblies will be going out here. So it is the responsibility of the discrete job managers to make it run, and then what happens, nothing gets automatically moved at all. He only will update it upon completion of a job. So nothing gets automatically moved. So once the district job manager goes to this place, go to move transaction and then move the assembly explicitly, then only what happens, it will now move. Go to this place and then explicitly move, it will now reflect over there. So it is for the DJ managers to update it.
In general, what we have seen is that once it's already there and job is there, we only come to the one order is finished. I mean,
this is a practical problem in many industries. What happens is that nobody makes the move transaction intermediate at all. Even in Metrology, I have seen 2-3 companies. What happens? In the morning, once when they come in, they log in, and afterwards, before they log out, they fully complete everything. So actually speaking, what happens, they have to update the status as and when it is completed. So then what happens, the top management can very well understand about how many assemblies are there and how many operations. But that doesn't happen at all, actually. This is basically a discipline, and then this has to be followed strictly by the DJ managers. Or the company has to give an instruction. Otherwise, what happens? Many, many companies do not do this at all.
Technology, RFID technology project is the total visibility. We could go off and start wearing how the product moves between one operation to other operation. Automatically, when the product moves,
that's what RFID is a very good technology, and then that has automated so many things, and then it has even imposed some discipline in the manufacturing also. I heard about it. So that's in fact a very good technology, and then that is getting integrated into many, many projects in fact. That's a good technology. Only thing is, here manufacturing, the discipline must be there, otherwise what happens, there is no meaning in having all these things. If they don't enter it, then they will not be knowing exactly how much is the cost here, as well as how much the time has been spent. And then the planned timing as well as the actual timing, they have to see. So if you go there, it will not show you everything here. The DJ will be telling you when the first operation is going to start, when the last operation is going to start. So minute by minute scheduling is very much possible in this place, and then that is not exactly followed. That is the biggest problem in many industries. So the purpose of costing, this is basically what it gives you, the time management as well as the cost management. So if you go there and then go to the operations, what happens, it will now give you the date exactly. Every operation, when it is going to start, when it is going to complete. And then here what happens, the first unit started as well as the last unit got started is going to be same. So because what happens, all the assemblies are moved together in every operation. But this discipline does not take place at all in industry. That is the biggest thing. Now somebody has to enforce in the top line that they have to do it as per this. So now we are going to go for the next topic. That is, if one parent is going to be lot serial control as well as the component is also going to be a lot serial control. So now here an item now. Go to the inventory items, master items. I am going to give a new item now. So the item is now getting created. So 30_EFG. I am creating it. 30_EFG2. I will apply the template. Purchase item template is applied. So here I go to the inventory and then make the SLR enabled. It is now serial control as well as it is now lot control as well as it is now revision control. So all the three controls are now enabled here. Correct. So now that I am going to assign this space to organization. Alt T and then move. Space bar commit. Now that. So go there, control down arrow. Here. I will now go for the next one. 30_. Then C1. I am making a component here. Having a component C1. And then this is also going to have everything. Sorry, first one should have been what's called a finished good now. I made a mistake here. So I will now, this is a purchase item. This is a purchase item. And then I will now enable this full control. And then I will now enable it. So I will now make the first one as fine. I will now apply the will now make one more item again. One from down above. 30_EFG22. 30_EFG22. I will apply the finish would complete now. Yeah. And then this item is going to have all the controls now. So the parent as well as the component is having all the SLRs enabled, serial lot and revision enabled. I will not create a bill now. I will not create a bill. I will not first of all make a routing now.
For this. Can I start to send a component to M1?
Oh God, I have not done it. Items, master items. Go over there. 30% page. C1. See whether this is my item or not. Yeah, this is my item. So I will now assign this to organization M1. Now I will now create a bill now. I will now create a bill. I am now interested in the item material. So for example, over the bill of materials, go to routing. First you create the routing now. First you create the routing. So 30% to beta number one. So just for understanding purposes, we are now putting it in one of the things. So there. And then I will now create a resource now. Based on the resource. Because if there is no routing, we cannot perform any move transaction of this. So 30% one. We will now give one here. Share your name. Yes, commit. It is not done. Come out of it. And then now for this I am going to create a bill now. Go there. Go to tools and then go to bill. So in the bill part, what happens? I am going to give this and then it is required for operation of button. Fine. You cannot create. So parent record is not given yet. So go there. And then it is 30% 22 and then go attack. So for which I am going to create. For the 10th operation, fine. Component is what? It is 30% C1. So C1 is a component. So this is basically what? The serial lot control as well as the parent is also serial lot control. Correct? Now done. I need one quantity. So now I am going to create a job for this and then I will now perform a move transaction. We will now see what happens. I will now perform a move transaction. So go there and then create a job. Go to this three jobs and then create a new job now. Hit one view. So go there. And then the job is what? 30_job 5. Go there. Assembly is what? 30% 22 you have. And then go for 10 quantities now. The start is now given. Fine. And then go to the routing and then give the finish good also. Fine. So let's say the finish good is okay. So we are now given. Commit. I will now release the job. The job is now released. Commit. Now I will not perform a move transaction. Here remember the component needs what? The serial lot and revision number. So I will not have sufficient quantity in the inventory because it needs a serial lot revision number. So go there, go to inventory, go to transactions, go to miscellaneous transactions, then we will not see sufficient quantity of this component. M% RE. 0100-215-4030, and then go to the transaction lines now. Item is what? 30% C1 on your tab. Another one. Revision. Control here. I will not give only one division. Subinventory. Control here. I will not. Make it in stores. Keep it in stores. Go there. Lot number is lot 100. Go there. And then I will not see. Take 100 quantities. 1000 quantities. It's not done. So we have sufficient of this morning commit. It is all done. So, but we have to now mention the serial numbers also. Go down and mention the serial numbers. So let us say 1001 to 2000. The serial numbers I am getting. So we have sufficient quantities in stores. So once when you perform the move transaction, you will see what happens. You are done and then commit. We have sufficient quantity in the inventory now. Is not done, come out of it, come out of it. We will not perform the move transaction now. Go to this. So the move transaction. We are not performing the move transaction now. So the job file, 30% file, and then you have 10. Fine. From 10, there is only one operation there. Still moving. I'm going to go. Go for one quantity now. Now I'm going to commit. Remember, this component is required now. So this component will be having what? I think I'm not sure about whether I have made an operation pool or not. I will now see that I am making it as an operation pool. So what I will do is I will now go to this place, I will put the job, I will now modify this, go to job schedule details, and then go to the material requirements of this job. So it is 30% higher than you have handed out. I will now see the supply date. So it is assembly pool, I will now make it as an operation pool. So this is upon completion of this operation, fine. The stores, there is now some stores have to commit, not that. So upon completion of this operation, this item will be automatically pulled into this. Come on, not that. So and then make this move transaction. Move transaction is the one which are making it. You go there. You're making it. So 30% spike and then go that. And then for 10, and then I'm going to go for 10 to move. Moving it. I'm moving one assembly now. Commit. If you commit, what happens? The system will automatically pop up. The serial lot and revision number are required for the component now. So the message is now coming up. So backtrack transaction has now come up. So it is now populating all the things. So here we have to fill up everything, then only it will be possible for you. So go for this lot. Go there. And then everything is now populated. The stores, everything is there. All things, the serial number has been given now. So go down and then give the serial. Give the state of the lot. Fine. The lot number. Control here. Yes. I'm now using the lot. This is 1. And then give the serial number. I cannot give it then because it's serial control also. So we have to give the serial numbers also. So accept it and then give the serial number also. Take some serial number. So let's say 1004. Like that. You are done. It's done. Fine. You are done. Now we can perform the commit now. Click on done. So this screen will now commit. The vector screen will commit now. So because it's an operation tool, the vector screen will come. So accept it done. Now the move transaction is performed. Soft flow transactions are complete. You can see the bottom. So if any of the components is serial or lot controlled, the system will automatically pop up a message. Now I will now try to complete the job. I will now complete the job. So go for 30% expire and then go back. There's no go for completion. It is not possible at all. Assembly under serial lot control, no, okay. No completion is allowed from this form at all. If the parent is going to be having any of the controls, inventory controls, we cannot perform any completion from here. So what you have to do? You have to go to the completion transaction form and then perform the completion. If the parent is going to be serial or lot controlled or revision controlled. So from this we can only move to the last step. It is only possible for us to move up to the last step, whereas we cannot complete from this form straight away. And during this process, if any of them is lot controlled, the form will automatically pop up. The backtrack form will automatically pop up and then ask for the details. Now here what you have to do, go to material transactions and go to completion transactions here. Here we have to say. You go to completion transactions and then here we are going. So it is 30% spike and then we have that. The one. So keep on continuing. Here, what happens? He is now asking you how many quantities you want to complete. And break it in one. Only one is available today. So once I have gone through this field, may cancel it. So here you see, available to complete is now one here. Once when you come to the screen, the available to complete is now automatically coming as one. Keep on continuing, we are going to continue this stuff. This screen has come now. So the FGS, the finished good subinventory, you go there, available to complete is one now. You tap, and then go there, and now give a save. Give it done. So the lot serial numbers is now popping up. Click on lot serial numbers, there is now coming up. So the lot number you can now give. So I now go to generate. Click on generate. Now once when you generate, what happens? Yes, 00150 is now coming up. We will now see from where it is coming up. Fine. It generate is now coming up. And then complete this. And then give it up. This is coming up. Yes, 00150. Where you are going? Where is coming up? When you generate the lot thing, please enter the serial numbers also. Click on serial numbers because it's serial control also. So you will say 101 and then go back. It's taking up. It's done. It is not done. And then if you complete it, what happens? Now, this assembly will be going in inventory, which is S00150 with 101 as a serial number now. It is not completed. So, it is now inventorized now. You go to the space, go to on-hand availability, on-hand quantity, and then have another thing. So, click on this, and then query this item, and 30%, 22 is the one. Click on find. You can now see it is available in the inventory at this place, M1, and this FGA, and then this is the one. This is the revision, and then this is the lot number, and then this is the serial number now. So these are the items, revisions, lot and serial number. Now from where from the lot number is picked up when you keep on generate, you are going to see now. The lot number is coming automatically. So when you keep on generate, where from it is coming up. You go to the width parameters now. Go to width parameter. Yep. Set up, then parameters. You go down, and then see the parameters here. So here, what happens, the default lot number is based on inventory rules. It is based on inventory rules. So the default lot number is now coming up from inventory rules. So what the inventory says, we will not see. You go to the space, go to the inventory, go to setup, go to organization, go to parameters. If you go to parameters, inventory setup organization parameters, the navigation, if you see on the third tab region, now have another way for the third tab region. Here, it will now say, the prefix is yes, and then the number is coming up automatically. So yes, 150, and then the total length is 6. So because of it, what happens? It has now populated, yes, 00150. So it has now padded with the zeros also. So depending upon the inventory rules, you find, where from you have to generate. If it is from the item level, it will not generate from the item. If it is from the R level, it will not from R level. So whichever way you are given, accordingly the numbers will be generated. Once when you click on generate, so, go to the working process parameters, so that's all it. Now, I will now set it up as job name now. Now, it is now set as job name, correct. Now, I will now perform the move transaction. I don't know whether it will get affected now itself or otherwise it will be coming in the next. I'm not sure about it. Now, see what happens. You go to the dip, and then go to move transaction, and then perform move transaction. For the fifth job, go there. This 30% takes away, and then you attack. From here, we can only move the last step now. Just one more quantity and then commit. We will now perform a completion transaction of this. We will now see what it comes. It is now asking for it. The component is now asking for it. We go down and then give it that and then give a lot. No lot. Now, what happens? Lot number. You cannot generate the lot number of a component mainly because what happens? You are now issuing from the store. So, while issuing, you cannot generate it. So, what happens? You are now going to go there, control here. And then the lot is coming, or the only lot which is available there, and then go to one, and then give a serial number. Here also you cannot generate any serial numbers because you are issuing it out. So if you say, nana_101, it will not accept it out. So that means serial number is not available. Whatever is available in the inventory, we can issue. Go there. We are issuing for the lot. So 103, 104. 104 is already issued, we can see. 106, I mean, 1006, I am issuing it. Go down, and then give it done. It is now done. Keep on done. It is now done. So, the assemblies are not performed. Give it up. Now, the shop floor transaction has been performed for the 10th operation for 2 move now. Now, you go there and then perform it. Go there and then you go and then perform it. Go and then see this move transaction. Go and then completion transaction I'm going to perform. go to completion transaction and perform the completion transaction for the job with 30% fine. He says one assembly is now eligible for, already one is completed, one is eligible for completion, click on continue. Now here, you go there and then put the quantity as 1 here, and then go down, and then click on lot serial numbers. So if you click on generate the lot number, the job number will be coming as a lot number. Click on generate. Now it is not coming, but if you go for the next one, because this job is already created, so if you create a new job and then see, this number will be actually the job number. The lot will be generated as a lot number. That's what I want to inform, but it has to be done on the next job. It has to be done on the next job. So go there and then come. This is not going as a serial number that we entered. So fine. The two more things. Here we can generate numbers because what happens, you know, bringing into the inventory with any number, you can do it. There is no one. Click on that. You can take the performance. Correct. The move transaction is not performed. So there are two options available here on this place on the parameters. One is based upon the job name or based upon the thing, based upon the inventory. Now respond to sales orders. Next is respond to sales orders. It says it's always. So you will now have a response to the sales orders always. We will now go to sales orders and then we will now create the sales orders. Go to order management. You will now try to find out the ATO model now straight away. You go to the inventory, you go to items, master items. We have to find out the ATO model in your month. You go for the 30% and then the user item type is ATO%. Control F11. Nothing is available there. You must say ATO. ATO item is basically item. ATM. Not exactly. So now go for ATO item now. Yeah, we got ATO item now. So this ATO item can be manufactured in GIF now. So take a copy of it and then we'll now create a sales order for this. And then we will not try to manufacture it in GIF. Somewhat of it, you know, going to make a sales order. You go to orders and returns and then go to sales orders. Here, we are going to create a sales order. So, the parameter says it is always. Whenever there is a change by the customer, what happens? It gets reflected automatically over here. You go to others. Then make it as M1 now. It's not that. Same time we are going to go on the inside. The customer's key reference in order funds does not. Now we will now create a sales order for this ATO item now. Paste it and then get that. Then I'm going to go for one quantity and get that. Remember, the models and option classes must be either created or common to IVO. That is the one thing which you have to remember. So go there and then now give a commit. Control of commit is not done. Now I will now book the order. So upon booking, what happens? You know, the customer is confirming it by booking. Now the status of booking entered now. You can see the status is now going to enter. Then go there and then book it now. Click on book order. You are now booking the sales order now. Now booked. Now I will now progress the order. It will become supply eligible now. Become supply eligible. So go to actions and then now perform a progress now. Progress. So once when you progress it, what happens? The job order gets created automatically. Click on it. It will be creating a job order now. So it has now submitted a concurrent for creating a job order. Go there. And then have a look at the concurrent. Auto create final assembly orders is now running. Auto-create final assembly orders is now running. So upon completion of this, you can go on and see a job would have been mass loaded into it. Now look at it. you can see the job getting mass loaded in the web. So this is a mass loading of the job. And then the job number is 89905. It is for one quantity now. Can I take a copy of it? It is for one quantity. Can I show that? Go there. So go to this place, go to Navigator now, and then go to WIP now. Go to WIP. And then now, go there. Go to discrete. Go to discrete jobs. Very important thing, you want to save a copy of K6 and your tab. Find out this job. Now, it is in an unreleased status. In fact, you release it now. It is now released. Connection. Now, the customer is now going to cancel this order. He is going to cancel this order. So, it is in a released status. It has been released. So, come on up it. Now, let the customer cancel. You go to the place, all W go to the place order. So, go inside. Now, you go to the main item. And then make the quantity as zero now. The customer is coming. Record has been changed over here. You have to re-query it again. So you just go there and then re-query the sales order. Take a copy of it. Go to query mode. Finish it and then query, re-query. So we go into the lines region. Now he is going to cancel it. You can see now this is now production open the status. Right? Production open the status. So he is now cancelling this order. Okay, I'm putting this only a zero commit. So you're going to give the reason for the cancellation. And then you okay. What happens? He committed again. Now what happens? The job which has been released to work in process will not see what happens to the job. Go there, all W, and then go to navigate now. Go to tools, not there. Go there, go to the discrete jobs. And then query the job.
Job number is not that one.
So job number is
request.
You go to this place where the appropriate hand assembly order, take a copy of it. And then 89905 is the job number. Take a copy of it. Then close it. And then query the job number now. Discrete job. And out. Now what happens if you go and then see the quantity here? You go to the sales order, reference it. What happens? There is nothing here at all. So what happens, the sales order reference, I would have shown the sales order reference in the previous one. So that quantity has been removed as it. But what happens if you make it as unreleased, what happens if you know, automatically put on hold also. I will not get one more sales order because not shown it here. So I will not get one more sales order. So what is the item again? So we will not go there. I will not put the latest one. No, take up the item now. Not sure about it. Whether we can do it in the same system or not. Let's see whether I can do it in the same system or not. Go there. And now go for three quantities. And then your tab. It is already in a what's called, if that has been cancelled, right? No, three quantities. And commit, we'll see what happens here. Right. It is now in what state is supply eligible. I will now make an action here. Go there. If actions and then progress order. Entering. Create supply order eligible. Okay. The center has been launched. Now we'll correct. So, all tab. You go there, then view the output of it. I'm going to take the job number now. Mm-hmm. 89906 the job number for 50 quantities. Close it. And then have a look at it. This place. You go to the navigator. You go to the quick job. And then case it and find out That was like a nice thing. You go down and then have a look at this sales order reference. It will not show you. This is a sales order. It is now the primary quantity reserved is 50. Now the concern is now coming. The customer is now reducing the quantity in the sales order. It will get communicated immediately over here. You can see this all double your bonus sales order. This page now. He is now reducing it to say 28 now. We have now requeried it. Go up and then requeried this. Take a copy of it. Now go to query mode. Requeried it. Here he is now reducing it to say 28. You can see the status is correction open now. 28 commit. Reason you are giving. And then you okay. You're not committed. Now this will have a perpetual communication to work immediately. So you can go there, go to the name here. And then you go to the print job. This what is it? Remember?
89906.
89906. Okay, very good. You go there and then hand out. So it is in this case, right? You go there and then have a look at it. The sales order is called. This gets the perpetual communication. It is an release or unreleased mode. Now, if you have that one as a, now you know, cancel it totally, you will not see what happens. You know what happens, you are going to cancel it. Before which, what happens, I am now going to make the width parameter. Okay, fine. Go there and make it one, change the width parameter. Give a width parameter and then go to setup and then go to parameters. If you make it as say 1-to-1, then link it 1-to-1, that is this sales order will link to only one job, that job will be kept on hold in fact. That job will be kept on hold if it is linked to 1-to-1. Otherwise what happens, it will only say the quantity will be met the thing. If it is linked to 1-to-1, then what happens, it will be kept on hold as it is now. You go to this place and then go for the sales order and then make it cancel now. I know what it cancels now. Make it a 0. 0 is going to cancel it. Commit. Give a reason. Enter it. You okay? It is not done. Commit. Now, here, what happens is that this is going to basically make the job on hold. I don't know whether now it will come or not. 89906. Go there. 89906 and then go to this is not doing, we have to do a new job on NC. But you can see the sales order is not coming up. It is now removed totally in the quantity which is required. But what happens if you do on a new job after the setup is there, then the status will go to on hold in fact. And I'm not sure about it. If after release it will go to hold or something like that. But there is a difference between link to 1-to-1 as well as the thing. That will now make the status as hold also, on hold. Maybe after it is released, you can just try this. So this is the combination for this. Now you go to the width parameters now. This is the one. So this is the default job number, this is the one. Go to the repetition schedule. Yes. Then you wanted to close the costing assets. So reorganized period releases, all schedules are cancelled and complete no charges only. There is a big note which is available on costing. So that will give you clearly about how the variances are charged once the repetitive schedules are closed. And then auto release days will now see very shortly. For the move transaction of the fine, whether you want to require a separate scrap account for charging, allow creation of new operations is always on. So by this what happens, you now create a new operation as a share. Allow move or no move, this has to be on. Then only what happens, we can make there move and then we can make enable there. And then the backslash, what happens, from which supply subinventory is going to be there, it is a mandatory field. We have to give one of the fields as a share. If nowhere is available, the job will be getting defaulted with this supply subinventory. If it is not available in the bomb and with, it will not be available in the item, then from here, it will now get defaulted in the job. So the job will try to default to this supply subinventory right from bomb. If bomb is not having, it will now go to the item and then try to do it. If it is also not available in the item, it will now automatically default from this place. Similarly, the question, not selection method, right? It is basically on the result kit. Whichever is going to expire first, whichever is going to receive first or expiring first, you will be doing it for selection for this. Whenever you are going to have a push component, then you are going to have the fixed release impact. This is used by the soft flow scheduling, underneath for launch selection method. Fine. And then basically, lot verification is also used by this. Release backslash components is always selected. And then all the allow quantity changes during backslash So we can even make a change if you do it, and then while you're doing a backslash manually, we can even change the quantities. Otherwise, it will be grayed out. And these are the interoperation steps. Whichever you want, you can use it. And then this is for outside processing. We'll be having a look at it on Monday. We have a manufacturing collaboration business, whatever they're showing it. This is for shop floor scheduling. Shop floor scheduling will be using this tab, as well as mobile will be using some of the tabs, some other modules. All those things are used by other modules as well. So few reps will be using only some minimal tab regions here. So we will not see what is a repetitive schedule. So that is the one which is now pending there. So repetitive schedule is nothing but is almost like a normal job only. Here what happens is you go to the setup, and then first of all it is a line production. First of all you will not define the lines now. Production lines will be defined with setup production lines and navigation variant. You will not define the production lines. So it is 30_line1. In which what happens, I am going to say summary is the minimum hours, say 50 quantities is the minimum one, and the maximum you can produce is say 100. And then we're going to work from say 8 o'clock onwards up to say 5 o'clock. But and then the basis will be, lead time will be based upon normally routing date. You won't be having a 16. Because if it is a different one, you can do it. If it is a fixed lead time, you will not tell how much is the lead time. Otherwise, it will be routing based normally. So, come it. This is only for the other modules, for tolerance services. How much of advanced information has to be given for using this? So, the line is created with a hourly minimum rate. Now, what happens? Now, we'll go to the job schedule. Go to this place. Go to repetitive. Now, what happens? We will now create the repetitive schedules now. We go to the, okay, the repetitive schedule. So, go there. Sorry. You have to now associate the lines to assemblies now. Next is, the line has been created. In this line, what are the assemblies that can be manufactured? We will now associate it. Go there. The line is what? 30, and then go tap. And then the assembly is what? I'm going to have 30%. 1. So 30%. You have to see item 1 is the assembly I'm going to make. So here what happens? We have to have an accounting class as repetitive. That you have an accounting class as repetitive. So one of the accounting classes now made in the system. So one accounting class is a must here. Thereafter the separate can be given. It's based on them, and then the planning you can download. Now in the same assembly, what happens? You can even manufacture this. One more also can be manufactured. 30% each. One. So let us say these are the assemblies which can be manufactured in this line. That is what we say. It's not committed. So how many assemblies you can manufacture this line? We are now giving it. So having associated the lines to assemblies, what happens? You will now define the repetitive schedule now. It's all done. Now go to the repetitive schedule and then define the repetitive schedule again. So line 1, 30% data. The assembly, I'm going to manufacture 30% data. Second one. It is now in unreleased status. You go to the state quantities. How many quantities you want to have? So you have got three things. One is the daily quantity, days, and then total quantity. You give one of them, the remaining will be calculated. Say, I will say 100. Number of days is 2. This will be calculated. So out of the three, if you give 2, the remaining 2 will be calculated. Go to the start date. There are first unit start date and then the last unit start date. In the case of discrete, what happens? Both of them are discrete. Whereas in the case of repetitive, what happens? They will be different. So there are 4 dates that are available here. First unit start date, last unit start date. First unit completion date, last unit completion date. You give out of the 4, one of the dates, the system will automatically recalculate the balance. Let us say I am not giving something. So if the system will be recalculated, the balance one is only committed. Go to the bill. So if you have anything, the other comments, you can just leave it blank and then you can commit. Commit. You can see the dates are getting recalculated now. The start dates and then the completion dates are recalculated. So afterwards what happens, we can now see, this is my unreleased mode, go there. And then the same line, I am going to manufacture 30% 1. So you one, that it is an unreleased status. So here also you give one of the reads, right? Go there. So now you give some other reads, you go to the bottom. Okay. Now, once again, I will now make it as in the 6th of August. 06. 06. August 2008. And then commit. There is a first unit start date commit. So you must enter 2 of the following daily quantities, days to depend. 2 of the quantities are being entered. So quantities are not being entered. So let us say I want to have 100. And the number of days is 200. And maximum, I can do it. Commit. It is now done. Remember, the first unit has got a start date, it is now having 6 of So here, what happens? I am now going to perform this repetitive transaction now. Over there. So here, it is in the unreleased status. And before that, what happens? I want to set up the WIP parameter now. Now the parameter is there. The WIP setup. And then go to parameters now. In this case, what happens? Auto release days is there. Let us say 2 days. If the first job is completed, if any other job is within the WIP 2 days, the system will automatically release now. It will not automatically release now. Auto release days is not true. So go there. And now you perform this line transaction now. You go there, go to WIP. Then go and have a look at the job now again. Go to place. Now it's the line production now. So on 13th line, what happens? What you have done is we are now created the schedule. Have a look at this repetitive schedule which you made. Double click on it. And then control of program will now give you all the schedules over here. So on the 13th line one, we have got two such things. Right? So the first one I'm going to release it now. Right? This is the first one. Which I have not planned. Go to the start it and have a right. This is on the 5th of this thing. So go to the quantities, go to the status and then I don't know, make it release. Right? So release commit. Now upon completion of this, what happens? This will get automatically released if it is within the release time sense date. I will not complete this assembly on this line. So line assembly is a unique combination of this thing. Apart from that, every move transaction are all the same. One of it, you go there and then perform the move transaction for this line. So move transaction, verification graph, we are going to perform the line transaction. So the job is what? Not the job, but the line. You have to get the line. At any point of time, only one activity will be done. So go there, control S. So percentage can now see there is only one release job that will be getting automatically populated over here. So it's not coming. So go there and then put it. Now I will not perform completion straight away for this. Okay, then you have. I am going to complete 100 quantities. Either way, not 100 quantities I am going to complete. All the quantities are getting completed. Now these are getting completed. So the transactions are almost same as far as this thing is concerned. But as far as line production is concerned, one thing is on a line you will now make. So for a repetitive schedule, what you do is you go there, first of all go to the setup and then define all your lines over here. The production lines are defined over here. So after having defined all the production lines, you go there, you go to the repetitive and then you associate the lines to assemblies now. One assembly, how many assemblies can be manifested in this? Then finally, make the repetitive schedule. The balance are same like a discrete job. Now you go there and then go to the repetitive schedule and then have a look at it. Central command. Okay. This is not complete, and this will get automatically released. I don't know why it's not getting released. This has to get released because it's well within the rank. The start date has come. I think it's comparing with the system data. The system data is getting compared and so that's why it is not getting released. Because that's been released only on 6th of August. Whereas system data is not so. So if you create a date on today and tomorrow, what happens? It will not release it for production. And then accordingly we can manufacture. So this completes the repetitive schedule. Now we have to see manufacturing collaboration, what? The OSP operation. So that manufacturing collaboration will be seen on Monday morning, but then afterwards we will now see the average costing. Till now we have seen the standard costing, we will now have a look at the limits of the average costing also. So that is another way of costing it. So by which what happens, they complete this. So we will now assemble at 7 a.m. on Monday morning. I am not 6:30 because I will be reaching the Bangalore City station only at around 5:30. So I need 1.5 hours to reach here. So at 7 o'clock on Monday morning, we will now resume the next session and the last session on this. And from Tuesday onwards, the financials will start. The training on financials will start from Tuesday onwards. Okay. So good night and then happy weekend and then we will again meet on Monday morning Indian time at 7 a.m. Any queries you can write to me so that what happens I can just do it. And then the AT&T department has told that it is very difficult to upload everything, so they are now going to put it on a common folder. So you can write to Nagaraja as well as Renil. We will give you the details about where exactly you have to take it. Okay. So thank you and good night.
The conference call now.